वो साइड पे क्लिक कीजिए। हाँ
किया।
ओके। डियर ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स, आई वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर दिस आवर आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चरल हेरिटेज ऑफ इंडिया। दिस न्यू सेशन एंड आई वेलकम हियर डॉक्टर मुनमुन मुंडल जी फॉर दिस न्यू सेशन। मैं पहले उनका परिचय यहाँ पर देना चाहूँगा। जितने भी हमारे सारे प्रतिभागी है, सहभागी है, उन सभी को मैं उनका पहले परिचय देना चाहूँगा। वो बेसिकली कलकत्ता वेस्ट बंगाल से है और उनका एकेडमिक जो है, उन्होंने अपना पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन आर्कियोलॉजी में यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ कलकत्ता से कंप्लीट किया है। उसके बाद अपना पीएचडी 2013 में उन्होंने यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ कलकत्ता से पूरा किया। एंड देन शी कंप्लीट पोस्ट डॉक्टरल फेलो फ्रॉम 2014 टू 2016 फ्रॉम सेम द यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ कलकत्ता। अगर उनका वर्क एक्सपीरियंस अगर देखा जाए तो उन्होंने एज अ डॉक्यूमेंटेशन असिस्टेंट के तौर पर कार्य किया नेशनल मिशन ऑन मॉन्यूमेंट्स एंड एंटीक्विटीज, विच इज वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट एक्टिविटी ऑफ दिस आवर आर्कियोलॉजिकल सर्वे ऑफ इंडिया। यहाँ पर उन्होंने 2010 से लेकर 2010-2011 में उन्होंने अपना कार्य किया। सॉरी, इन्होंने फेब्रवरी 2014 से लेकर 2016 तक ये जो बाद में और उसी में कार्य किया था, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ कलकत्ता डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ आर्कियोलॉजी कैटलॉगिंग एंड एग्जीबिशन सेटअप में डॉक्यूमेंटेशन असिस्टेंट इन नेशनल मिशन ऑन मॉन्यूमेंट। वो 2010-11 का वर्क है और ये डॉक्यूमेंटेशन असिस्टेंट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ आर्कियोलॉजी में 2014 से 2016 तक का वर्क है। और कई सारे उनके बाकी अदर भी वर्क है, मगर मैं यहाँ पर बताना चाहूंगा, शी इज वर्किंग एज द क्यूरेटर फॉर हिज हाइनेस महाराजा सर शिवाजीराव सिंधिया म्यूजियम, जयविलास पैलेस, मध्य प्रदेश, ये ग्वालियर में जो एक बहुत ही अच्छा म्यूजियम है। सितंबर 2017 से लेकर वो कार्य कर रही है वहां पर। उन्होंने कलेक्शन मैनेजमेंट एंड एग्जीबिशन सेटअप केस में कार्य किया है एंड आउटरीच एंड मैनेजमेंट प्रोग्राम, इसके भी उनके कई सारे वर्क है। एज अ प्रोफेशनल कोर्सेज अगर देखे जाए तो उन्होंने कई सारे कोर्सेज भी कंप्लीट किए हैं एंड उनको जो फेलोशिप अभी तक प्राप्त हुए है, चांस वेल्स इंडिया ट्रस्ट शॉर्ट टर्म फेलो के इसका फेलोशिप उनको प्राप्त हुआ जो ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनाइटेड किंगडम की तरफ से। उसके बाद पोस्ट डॉक्टर रिसर्च फेलोशिप उनको ICSSR की तरफ से प्राप्त हुआ था। जूनियर रिसर्च फेलोशिप जो उनको प्राप्त हुआ था वो भी ICHR की तरफ से प्राप्त हुआ था। फील्ड एक्सपीरियंस में अगर देखा जाए तो एक्सप्लोरेशन एंड एक्सकर्शन में उन्होंने 10 साल तक कार्य किया है। देन रिसर्च पेपर्स उन्होंने अभी तक 14 नेशनल एंड 10 इंटरनेशनल लेवल रिसर्च पेपर्स प्रेजेंट किए हैं। पब्लिकेशन में उन्होंने एक्सकर्शन ऑफ मुगल मराई ये किताब जो पब्लिश हुई तो उसके वो कोऑथर रहे हैं और 16 नेशनल पब्लिकेशन एंड 2 इंटरनेशनल पब्लिकेशन उनके प्राप्त अभी तक हुए हैं। अवार्ड्स और ग्रांट्स को अगर देखें सो शी रिसीव्ड मल्टीपल नेशनल एंड इंटरनेशनल फॉरन ट्रेवल ग्रांट्स टू प्रेजेंट रिसर्च पेपर्स इंटरनेशनली। और एरिया ऑफ इंटरेस्ट उनका जो है म्यूजियम फील्ड, आर्कियोलॉजी, आर्ट, आर्ट हिस्ट्री, एक्सकैवेशन, एक्सप्लोरेशन एंड फोटोग्राफी में रहा है। सो इस विषय में आज के जो इम्पोर्टेंट टॉपिक उन्होंने लिया है, एक बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक, फोक पेंटिंग्स ऑफ वेस्ट बंगाल। एक्चुअली जब हम आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चरल हेरिटेज की बात करते हैं तो ये फोकलोर, फोक आर्ट की बात हम करते हैं, मगर अभी तक के हमारे सारे सेशंस में एक भी सेशन इस टॉपिक पर नहीं हुआ है। सो ये एक बहुत खुशी की बात है और मैं यहाँ पर मंडल जी से विनती करता हूँ कि कृपया वो आज के अपने सत्र की शुरुआत करें। यस, नाउ यू प्लीज टॉक।
थैंक यू सो मच।
आपकी तरफ कई आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है।
नो, यू हैव अनम्यूटेड मी।
हाँ, यस, ओके, नाउ यू टॉक प्लीज।
थैंक यू सो वेरी मच फॉर दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी and I am really thankful to you. Good afternoon to all of you. Today I am going to discuss folk paintings of West Bengal. Folk painting is basically a part of folk art of a region. Now what is folk art? Folk art is a part of traditional life of a region or a country, providing an unbroken link with past, maintaining the social and religious as well as physical and economic ties with the soil. It is the art of people and community rather than the impression of individual creativity. Basically, folk art is an autonomous branch of artistic activity in its various local manifestations. So it includes folklores, proverbs, songs, dances, paintings, etc. Here, the historical time frame which I am going to mention, a Bengal painting, that is between 19th and 20th century, when Bengal was undivided. In 1971, Bengal was divided into West Bengal and Bangladesh. Today, I will focus on the folk paintings of West Bengal. As this course is a national level one, first, I will mention the location of West Bengal for better understanding of all of you. You can see in this slide that West Bengal is surrounded basically by Bangladesh in eastern side, Nepal and Bhutan in north, Bihar and Jharkhand in west, and Orissa and Bay of Bengal in south. Now, the folk paintings of West Bengal consist of Poto paintings and tribal painting. Poto painting is one of the most popular folk art of West Bengal. The word poto is derived from the Sanskrit and Pali word patta, which means cloth. The Bengal word poto means in general picture. It is essentially a local, regional and traditional art of Bengal. If we go through the origin and history of poto painting, that is unknown, the ancient and Buddhist missionaries went outside India to propagate the teaching of Lord Buddha, and they carried with them the cloth scroll paintings illustrating the Jataka tales. And these scrolls were called patta. Probably from these, the concept of poto painting came into existence. Now, characteristics and style of this painting. The compositions of this painting are based primarily on line drawing. Lines were finely drawn. The painters have strong preferences in natural colors. The brushes and the colors all are homemade by the artist or his family. Initially, the cloth is treated first for printing with thin paste or semi-liquid wash of fine clay or cow dung that is commonly found in rural life. Then, it was whitewashed with chalks or lime solution. The painters have strong preferences for natural colors. Like for black, they choose the lamp black. For red colors, vermilion and red lac was used. For yellow, yellow ochre were used. For blue, indigo was used. And sometimes from burnt stones, colors were made. Gum Arabic salt and water were used as binder, and gum of bell fruit were used for varnish. Now I will discuss the classification of poto painting. On the basis of shape and size, potos are divided into scroll paintings and square paintings. Now, what is scroll painting? In scroll painting, several events or themes relating to one broad subject is depicted. Like story of Krishna Lila, story of Ramayana, Chandi Mangal, or Mangal Kavyas, etc. But in square painting, it is rectangular or square pot where one single event or theme is depicted, like social humor, scandals, caricatures, satirical events, symbolic representation of contemporary society, all these things. Now I will discuss the scroll paintings first. The scrolls held vertically and painted from top to bottom, scenes after scenes, serially from Puranic and epic stories like Ramayana, etc. The pictures were arrayed in a columnar fashion, holding the sequence of the events or episodes intact. each of the complete picture was about 2 feet 6 inches long and 1 feet 6 inches broad. So minimum there were 6 to 7 panels. So the whole pot was about 11 to 12 feet or 13 feet in length. These paintings are produced and used for an educative and religious propaganda purposes. Potuwa's song, the whole story with narration. Now, I will discuss the themes. Themes from different Hindu Puranic stories, religious scenes, themes of musicians and artisans, flora and fauna, social life, all these are very common ones. To hang these long scrolls, generally two sticks were fastened on either side so it can be hung from top to bottom in a vertical rod. Now you can see these are the scroll paintings. The first one is consisted of 4 panels. This is Krishna Lila painting and this is Chandi Mangal painting consisted of 5 panels. For your better understanding, I will narrate one scroll painting depicting the story of Manasa, the Manasa Mangal Kabbo from Manasa Mangal Kabbo. It is a group of Bengali Hindu religious texts composed more or less between 13th to 18th century, notably consisting of narratives of indigenous deities of Bengal. Mangal Kabbo was written by Vipradas Pillai in 1545 AD. Is a masterpiece of medieval Bengali classic about the serpent goddess Manasa. It narrates how the snake goddess Manasa established her worship in Bengal by converting Chand Sadagar, a wholehearted worshipper of Shiva, to her own worshipper. Now, the major events which have been depicted in these panels are the following. The narration of Manasa Potus always start with the depiction of their preceding deity Manasa. You can see in the first panel, Manasa has been depicted, the snake goddess. Either she is seated on the snake or snake is there around her neck or in the next, absolutely in the next panel. In some long scrolls, these long scrolls are divided by prominent borders, mostly painted with vermilion red, yellow, or in black. The third and fourth panel of this photo painting is composed of with the scene of Lakshmindar and Behula and the procession regarding their wedding of Lakshmindar and Behula. Basically, Chand Sadagar, who was a worshipper of Lord Shiva, never wanted to worship deity Manasa. Deity Manasa wanted him as her worshipper. So during Chand Sadagar's son's wedding, Lakshmindar and Behula's wedding, Manasa played a game. Now I will tell you the story through this photo painting. These are the scene wedding of Lakshmindar and Behula. This panel is depicting the sealed iron, you can see here, sealed iron chamber for the Lakshmindar and Behula to pass their bridal night, erected by Lakshmindar. It was made of iron so that snake cannot enter. But Deity Manasa threatens the architect of the chamber to leave a hair-width hole in the wall of the chamber. Manasa orders Snake Kali to get into it, the chamber, through the tiny hole left by the architect and by the young man. Then the stab or pain awakened Lokhinder and Behula, and Behula saw the snake escaping. She throws a metal object to the snake and it cut off the tip of its nail. Behula realized that her husband is no more. She then prayed to her father-in-law Chand Sadagar to build her a river worthy crate that would carry her husband's body to the gods of heaven and also to Manusa to pray for his life. According to her wish, a crate was built by his father-in-law Lakshminder, and Behula started her journey to heaven along with her husband's lifeless body. During this course of her journey, she was attacked by different pirates, gamblers, just to divert her concentration. You can see this journey through the river Vaitarani. This is the river Vaitarani. Behula pottos are characterized by a typical style of linking of sub-panels with a continuous vertical panel depicting the river Vaitarani. The river flows down vertically, cutting across the panels, accommodating different sequences of the story through this waving course. This is itself a unique compositional scheme in the arena of folk painting. This is River Vaitarani and Behula's journey with her life's lifeless body. Now she prayed to Manusha, and Manusha felt pity to Behula to see her courage and devotion. Then Manusha sent Netu, her sister, in a form of washerwoman to the river to wash clothes. Behula recounted her sorrowful tale to her and begged Netu to direct her to the domain of Manusha and heaven. Now she has reached to heaven, to the court of Lord Vishnu, Brahma and Shiva. Vishnu, Brahma and Shiva have been depicted here. And Shiva was charmed and gave back the life of Lakshminder and his six brothers. The scroll ends with the scene of Behula Lakshminder boarded the vessel for return home with his seven brothers in the seven different boats. In the same panel or sub-panel, it is seen that Chand Sadagar is seen worshipping Manusha by his left hand and made various offerings, including animals such as goat, ram, etc. So, you can understand a full story has been depicted in one single scroll painting in different panels. Now, these long panels and scroll paintings are hung like this ladder, with this help of this ladder. Mainly these ladders are used in the developed countries, and it is very easy to hang these scroll paintings and to study it properly. Now very briefly I will discuss about the Potua Sangeet. The Potu painters were known as a community in Hindu society and termed as Patkars. Or in Bengali, they are called Patuas. Their settlement are known as Potuatala. They used to roam from door to door in village with these paintings and seeing the paint illustrations to make people more aware about the things they are painting. Mostly painters and songsters are the same person. Their lyrics were poor, but Potua songs were primarily associated with the whole tradition of image worship, gods and goddesses, Ramayana stories, etc. So their appeal were universal. These songs are a part of Bengal's folk culture, as they were never written, but orally composed and taught to others and orally preserved. Now I will move on to Kalighat painting. Our next topic. This is a lithograph, sorry, engraving of Kalighat of 1802. Kalighat painting is a type of this is Reti Kali. Kalighat painting is a type of a square painting that derives its name from the Kalighat temple in Calcutta. Kalinga temple is situated on the left bank of river Adiganga and was constructed in the 17th century by Santosh Roy Chowdhury, the Zamindar of Behalar area, a locality near Calcutta. 56 bighas of land were allotted to this temple. It is one of the most sacred religious Kalikshetra in eastern India. Nevertheless, this holy shrine attracted thousands of pilgrims from all corners of India and became very popular and important pilgrim center. Even the British officials of East India Company used to offer huge amount of money as homage to this shrine. The British administration and several other factors helped the creation of socio-economic condition at a religious center, which helped in the growth of Kalighat style. The Kalighat temple became a center of tremendous tourist attraction in Calcutta, the then cultural metropolis of India. From the beginning of early 19th century, a large number of Potuas from the western district of West Bengal started migrating in the neighborhood of this famous Kali temple in search of their better livelihood and to earn money. As a result, Potuapara of Kalighat sprang up. The art activities of these Potuas, which were some common technical and stylistic characteristics with traditional potu paintings, developed into an industry, turning out a great number of pictures to meet popular demands of pilgrims and others. They used to buy as an souvenir, mementos or token, just as a remembrance of their visit to this holy shrine. This potu painting became known as Kalighat painting as it grew up at the neighborhood of Kalighat temple. These paintings were also known as bazaar painting, as they were primarily intended for sale in market. As a popular art form, these artists are recognized for their use of brilliant colors, simplified images, and swift brush strokes that became the hallmark of Kalighat painting in 19th and early 20th century. These are the themes of Kalighat paintings, mainly religious and Puranic tales, nature and still life, historical events, everyday life, caricature, and symbolic. Handmade or machine-made paper. This is the characteristics and style of Kalighat painting. There are some differences between the scroll painting and Kalighat painting. There were changes on the base material from cloth to paper. Made of handmade and machine-made paper were used. The most unique feature of this painting is it was made on handmade and machine-made paper, not in cloth-like scroll painting, that made this painting as a cheap one, so people can easily buy it. At Kalighat, thin paper were used and mass production was there. But thick, stiff paper was used for creating more expensive and royal potus and finished with more care. Calcutta was the capital of British India from 1833 to 1912. There were emergence of paper mills, development of press and theatre movement, new wave of photography, which had a major impact on the contemporary society. Srirampur paper mill became very popular during this time, and for commercial purpose, paper used to come from this mill and also as a base material for Kalighat painting, as it was cheaper than cloth also. Shadow with line drawing were introduced in Kalighat painting to give the roundness relief and three-dimensional effect, which makes the painting more eye-catching. Potua Sangeet, which was very common for scroll paintings, were absolutely absent in Kalighat painting. And the themes were also changed due to socio-cultural change during this time. A I have already mentioned the themes. By 1830, artists had arrived in Kolkata from rural villages in Bengal and began to produce this painting that reflected the local history, mythology, customs, and conflicts of the colonized society. The traditional myths of Krishna Lila, Radha Krishna, Kamala Kamini, Manusha, Brahma, etc., represented in scroll painting, were being replaced by newly created myths of British rule generated Babu Bibi culture in Calcutta. In this connection, I must say the most remarkable contribution of this group of artists lies in the fact that under the new socio-economic setup, they were producing a satirical portraiture of contemporary society, especially the floppish Babu culture of town Calcutta. Influence of European artists and artworks were also noticed. Besides the religious subjects, there appeared the scenes of contemporary life, like hunting scene, like women with her sisters, jockeys, horse racing, all these things. Though Kalighat painting industry was to some extent indebted to the British rule also, but the actual execution of the photos, the British or Western influence were minimal. The new themes of social life, like emancipation of love of women, were boldly represented in Kalighat painting. Social humor, scandals, caricatures, satirical events are some of the notable themes found their place in this kind of painting. Here you can see some of the religious, this is a Shiva Panchanan, Shiva with five fists. This is Shiva Parvati, and Vasudeva with little Krishna crossing the river Jamuna. This is Hanuman. These are some of the religious Kalighat paintings. Now, the most important part of this painting is social themes. As I have mentioned, the Babu culture, which was reflected very much in Kalighat painting, you can see this is a depiction of a Babu. These are some of the paintings depicting the Babu culture, where Babus are sitting either with his mistress or they are taking shelter on her feet. This lady is selling fish to this Babu. With these paintings, you can see the decline in moral and social values set against an urban background were beautifully demonstrated in this painting. This is the most important part of Kalighat painting. Now, this is the unfinished painting, Kalighat painting. These unfinished paintings tell us something. A number of photos have been found where only top portion or layer of the basic painting, pencil drawing or sketch have been found. Maybe painting was postponed for next day, which eventually never done. From this, we can get the idea of this art technique. That is, first base drawing used to be done by pencil, then free strokes of brush, and then application of color. This is one of the famous incident that took place in 1873. And this episode of Alokeshwar of Tarokeshwar, known as the Tarokeshwar scandal or Tarokeshwar murder, was one of the very important subject of Kali, became one of the very important subject of Kaligat painting. As I have mentioned, it took place in 1873 in Kolkata. It rocked Kolkata almost. A young Brahmi, Nobin Chandra Banerjee, you can see on the left hand side that his neighbors are telling him something by holding his right hand. This young Brahmin Nobin Chandra Banerjee murdered his 16 years old wife Elokeshi at his village near the temple town of Tarukeshwar when he came to know that his wife is having an extramarital affair with Mohanto, the head priest of the Tarukeshwar temple. So it can be understood that contemporary society played a very important role as a theme of Kaligat painting. Again, these paintings showing the newly developed Babu culture, where women are trying to please the sophisticated Babu of the society. And the day-to-day life has been also reflected, like lady worshipping the Shivalinga or Yashoda making kheer. Now, some of the photos, Kaligat paintings, photo paintings, depiction of symbolic forms has also been noticed. Sorry. First, I will discuss this one. This is Chakshudan pot. Among these photos with magical themes, the most popular and widely known type is Chakshudan. This is a tribal pot, but it's a Kaligat pot also. That is why I have kept it here rather than in tribal section. Here, the theme depicts that the Jadu Patuas, they used to reach to the house of recently deceased person and shows a photo painted with a human figure without his eye to the family. The Patua proposes to draw the eye of the dead person against some gifts which would restore the eyesight of the dead man suffering from the blindness in the afterworld. This type of photo is entirely symbolic in nature, by which the artist wanted to suggest that by restoring the eyesight of the departed soul, he is giving direction to find out the right path in his next birth. These are some of the social scenes. This one is fake Vaishnava. This is another symbolic depiction. It is a symbolic representation of hypocritical activities of saint and the contemporary society. Here, a Vaishnava saint is sitting in a casual manner, bending his knees. He is holding a stick in one hand and a small bag from which peeps a rosary, apparently required for Vija Mantra. The Vaishnava, having long tuft on hair on his head, seven head, tilak on his forehead, a tulsi mala as necklace, and clad in a saffron dhoti, but just over his head, a parrot is perching. This bird and his stick were symbolically used in this painting to portray his greedy and fake character and more closeness to mundane affair that is not the ideal path of the holy Vaishnava saint. So all these are very much symbolic in nature and the contemporary society, reflection of contemporary society. This horse, it is called Duldul horse. This figure of a horse drawn with black strokes and red dots all over his body with a tonal shade of brush color has been identified as Duldul horse of Islamic mythology, generally used during Muharram. I have missed one slide, this one, cat with a fish. This is also symbolic representation, the same with the next one, that snake and fish one. That is depicting the contemporary secular theme like domination of higher or powerful class on weaker section. This period of painting in 19th century and the prevailing social scenario of the British domination on native people have been symbolically represented here. So I think I have completed this part. Here I must mention Bengal pot painting was never influenced by Mughal painting. If any similarities existed at all, that was with Orissan school of indigenous painting. But Orissan potto painting and Bengal, there are very strong differences between Orissan potto painting and Bengal potto painting. Very briefly, I will mention both states are similar in the sense they are cloth-based scroll paintings with the use of, organic colors. But their subjects, styles, and representations and designs are absolutely different. Fineness and intricacy characterize the Pottochitra of Orissa, whereas simple bold lines represent the Bengal Pottochitra. This is a difference you can clearly feel. There's the right one is Bengal Pottochitra with Parvati and Shiv. And left one is Durga. Though both are religious in nature, but their execution and depiction is absolutely different. Now I will move to tribal painting. It is practiced by the tribal people of Bengal, mainly Santals. The district of Purulia, Birbhum, and partly Bankura are inhabited by this tribe. Mainly the western and southwestern part of West Bengal. Their paintings, styles, and themes are almost similar to the scroll painting, depicting of animal hunting, social scenes, nature, etc. But religious scenes are quite less. Now I will move to the declining phase. These art potto painting started declining since the last quarter of 19th century, mainly under the impact of British rule, which destroyed the old autonomous village units with its cultural superstructures. The activities of the Potuas as a creative group are considered to have ended in 1930. This art faced a very tough competition with the reproduction of lithographs, oil paintings, color prints of 19th century, and also the lack of patronage from Rajas and the wealthy middle class families were also less responsible for this decline. Britishers never took any interest to preserve this art tradition. The socio-economic changes that took place in contemporary society probably compelled these Kaligat artists to choose some other livelihood for existence. Kaligat painting was basically an indigenous painting in all respect, technically, stylistically, and conceptually. It became very difficult for them to survive in the changing and challenging social environment due to the colonial empowerment in the late 19th and 20th century. When I have visited the Potuapara during my research work, surprisingly, I didn't find a single Kaligat artist. The traditional artist. Kaligat painting has lost its legacy and not a living art anymore. This painting has become a museum object almost, or a collector's item. The Potuas are doing the scroll paintings, but in their own way nowadays. They hardly have any knowledge about the original and traditional potto painting. Their newly painted scrolls do not represent any traditional folk styles that I have already discussed in my previous slides. In present time, photo painting exists in different forms. Potuas making paintings on earthen pot, like this one, which is called Shora, for religious purpose or worship of Hindu society, or they create a painting for decoration. Basically, this slide I'm showing you, it is a depiction of family of Durga on a Shora. Shora is a convex burnt clay plate which is whitewashed and then painted upon the same way as another pots are made. Nowadays, photo painting have become more commercialized, and for their livelihood, they have started basically to create this art on various medium to reach to the common people. They are painting on the sari, you can see. Sari are hanging there, dupattas are hanging there. I have taken this picture in a handicraft fair, and this is very common one. Even they are painting the photo painting, they are painting the photos on umbrella also. And cup set, earthen cup sets, cup, plate, all these daily usable things. Artists also paint their own house to attract people. And as I have mentioned, they are painting mainly on paper, occasionally on cloths, scrolls, as their forefathers did. Here the photo paintings you can see on the left hand side, they are newly made, not so much old. Very newly made and on very thin paper. So with this, I end my discussion, and I hope that people will be more interested to keep this tradition alive. Thank you so very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. It's a wonderful presentation. Just I have one question.
Yes,
is these paintings or this Pattachitra on cloth only, or they use leathers or the other materials also?
No, basically the original ones, the earlier ones were on cloth. Nowadays they are painting on paper or in earthen sora or earthen pots, like this cup, plate, tray, all these things, never on leather.
Okay, but before 18th century, in this old time, is it available only on the cloth?
Yes, absolutely, only on the cloth.
Okay, so nice. और ये पटचित्र जो है, या ये जो आपने बताया, ये सिर्फ बंगाल में ही प्राप्त होता है या आजू बाजू के किसी और रीजन्स में भी प्राप्त होता है?
नहीं, ओडिशा में प्राप्त होता है, दैट आई हैव ऑलरेडी मेंशन्ड, यू कैन गेट इट फ्रॉम ओडिशा आल्सो. And in Bihar, they are doing the Madhubani painting. All are folk paintings. So there are regional variations. Here in Pattachitra, you can see the same thing in Orissa, but the execution, theme, all these are different. In Bihar, in Jharkhand, you can see the different thing, but all are folk art, all are folk paintings.
Okay. और ये अभी तक जो प्राप्त हुए जो पटचित्र है, इसमें सबसे ओल्डेस्ट जो पटचित्र अभी तक प्राप्त हुआ है, ये कौन से पीरियड का है?
15th century.
15th century.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Okay. तो okay, so nice. ये आपने एक बहुत ही अलग इस पर प्रकाश डाला. और आज की तारीख में हम कई सारी आर्ट गैलरीज और अलग अलग जगह पर, जहां पर ये हैंडीक्राफ्ट मेला वगैरह लगते हैं,
yes.
तो वहां पर भी इस तरह के जो नए बनने वाले पटचित्र और ये है, वो सेल के लिए आते हैं.
यस, एब्सोल्युटली.
स्पेशली ओरिसा वगैरह से जो है, यहाँ से ताड़पत्र जो है, पाम लीफ के पेंटिंग्स वगैरह जो है, वो सेल होते हैं. जब हमने भुवनेश्वर वगैरह विजिट किया था, उस समय हमने वहां पर ये देखा था. तो मगर फिर भी ये फोक आर्ट को यानी जिंदा रखने के लिए ये एक जो नई पद्धति यूज हो रही है, इट्स टू गुड.
Yes,
इसमें आपने अभी जो पटचित्र बनाने वाले जो लोग हैं, क्या उसमें आज भी कुछ ऐसे लोग हैं कि जो सिर्फ नेचुरल कलर्स यूज करते हैं?
बहुत कम सर, बहुत ही कम, हार्डली 1-2%, हार्डली।
ओके ओके, सो वी कैन कॉल इट एज एन इंडिजिनियस आर्ट ऑफ इंडिया। जी जी, मैं
सभी नेचुरल कलर यूज करते हैं, उन लोग मेला वगैरह में नहीं आते हैं।
सही बात जी,
दैट आई हैव लोकेटेड।
ओके ओके, बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। एक्चुअली आपने अपना ये इतना यानी हेल्थ और ये सभी होने के बावजूद आपने हमारे लिए एक बहुत अच्छा प्रेजेंटेशन हमारे लिए किया, ये हमारे सबके लिए खुशी की बात है। मैं हमारे सारे सहभागियों से ये रिक्वेस्ट करना चाहता हूँ, जैसे हमने लास्ट टाइम भी ये कहा था, हमारे यहाँ ओडिशा के लिए डॉक्टर राजश्री पति जी ने एक प्रेजेंटेशन किया था, उसके पहले हमारे यहाँ डॉक्टर मेधा दुबे जी ने ग्वालियर और उस तरफ के मध्य प्रदेश के जो ये है उसके उसके बारे में उन्होंने प्रेजेंटेशन किया था। सो आई रिक्वेस्ट टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स, ये हमारी देश की धरोहर जो है अलग अलग राज्यों की, जैसे मध्य प्रदेश है, ओडिशा है, अभी आज हमने पश्चिम बंगाल और उसके बारे में देखा, तो आप अपने राज्यों के बारे में जो भी जानकारी रखते हैं, तो मैं ये विनती करना चाहूंगा कि कृपया आप अगर अपने राज्य की इस तरह की कलाएं और हमारी जो विरासत है, आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चरल हेरिटेज जो भी है, इसके बारे में अगर आप सभी के साथ जानकारी शेयर करना चाहेंगे तो मोस्ट वेलकम फॉर इट। मैं आपका यहाँ पर ये वेलकम करना चाहता हूँ। और जिनको ऐसा लगता है नॉट ओनली अबाउट द कंप्लीट आर्ट एंड आर्किटेक्चर, जैसे आज यहाँ पर इन्होंने प्रेजेंटेशन किया, आप स्टॉप प्रेजेंटेशन कर सकते हैं, स्टॉप प्रेजेंटिंग जो है उस पर क्लिक कर सकते हैं। तो इस तरह अगर आपको ऐसा लगता है कि किसी स्पेसिफिक जो आर्ट है उसके बारे में ही अगर आप बताना चाहेंगे, विच वी कैन कॉल इट एज एन इंडिजिनियस आर्ट, तो भी आप उसके बारे में जानकारी हम सभी के साथ शेयर कर सकते हैं। फिर से एक बार डॉक्टर मुनमुन मंडल जी का यहाँ शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ। और हाँ जी, और ये आपका जो अपने जो भी नॉलेज है आपके पास, इतने सालों से आपने जो पाया है और जो कलेक्ट किया है, being as a curator or before of that working as the research assistant and the documentation work, तो ये हम सभी संशोधन करने वाले, रिसर्च करने वाले लोग, रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स एंड ओवर ऑल दी पार्टिसिपेंट, सभी के लिए बहुत ही यूजफुल रहा। ये हमारा सफर जो है निरंतर जारी रहेगा, इसी अपेक्षा के साथ जो है हम यहाँ पर रुकते हैं। सो थैंक यू, थैंक्स अ लॉट अगेन मंडल जी, और हम फिर मिलेंगे। थैंक यू, थैंक यू, थैंक्स। यस जी।